Welcome. We've dedicated our entire album cover to any person who has ever sent us fan mail. This is your journey into life, love, and music.
Fan mail.
We'd like to thank you for your support. And
excited for what God has already done and what he's going to continue to do. We jump started it with Lawrence Pratt on last week. He dropped some beautiful gems as it pertains to business, even some hardships with losing everything and having to rebuild and restructure in a different way. But it gave us all hope at the end to see that God got the glory out of his life. And so for this evening, this morning, this afternoon, whatever time it is, wherever you are, we're going to be presenting Naisha Tyiease, the owner and creator of Tiamora's Closet. And so she's going to share some of her experience, how she transitioned from working in the health field to now working in the fashion industry. This message is specifically for the women. No offense against the men, but there's a lot that we deal with social media, in different images and different expectations. And her entire mission is to get every single woman to love the skin that you're in, to identify with the beauty that God has given you specifically, and to own it. And so on this night, this morning, this evening, this afternoon, we're going to kind of talk about that, what led her into her passion, and how her passion is now benefiting many, many, many others. And so I pray that this interview blesses you. I pray that you're encouraged. I pray that you leave with the strength in knowing that God created you uniquely, and he has great things in store for you, the one that he created and the one that he adores.
Sometimes I talk a little too much, don't listen enough. Sometimes it's way too easy for me to beat myself up. Sometimes I hate the way I look when I look in the mirror. One look from you, I know my flaws.
With it all, my flaws.
flaws. You love my flaws.
Hi, guys, and welcome to yet another episode on the Jesus Girl Entertainment Podcast. We are so grateful to have you with us. So for this morning, this evening, this afternoon, this night, we want to say thank you, thank you, thank you for tuning in to Anchor, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Listen Notes, Podbay, Podbean, and Amazon Music, and any other platform that I missed. Thank you, thank you, thank you for allowing us to stream on your platform. To everybody who has sent your words of encouragement, your prayers, your support, your donations, we are so grateful and thankful for the love. And so we are in our second week of the Rising Room season. I am so excited, so very excited for what is taking place and what's going to take place. On last week, we had an awesome and amazing interview with Lawrence Brett, owner and founder of College Match Pros LLC. If you guys haven't already done so, go ahead and go back and listen to that information that he shared. So many gems. He was very transparent and it was just very encouraging. And so on this night, for this morning, this evening, this afternoon, whatever time it is, wherever you are, we're going to be interviewing a young lady by the name of Naisha Tyiease. So, Naisha, if you can at this time, please introduce yourself to the viewers.
Hi, guys. My name is Naisha Tyiease. I am the owner and creator of Tia Mora's Closet, which is a women's fashion house, fashion emporium. I'm super excited to be here. I'm super grateful and I'm just ready to
Have you on with us. And so we're going to go into our first question, and that is, what inspired you to start your business?
Well, a lot of things inspire me, but to be quite honest, I grew up in a household of female entrepreneurs. My mom and my grandmother originally started a skincare line, and that was eventually passed down to my mother, who is a licensed medical esthetician. She's been in the aesthetics field since I was a child. So watching those two women in my life create a business from literally nothing, and watching the trials, the tribulations, the struggles, and the triumphs is what inspired me to always want to kind of be my own boss and not have to really answer to anyone. And then being a mother, I wanted to be able to spend time with my children and just create something that maybe one day I could pass down to them. I am a boy mom, but, you know, I still wanted to create something that they can, help me run.
I'm glad you made mention of that, too, because I am the owner of Jesus Girl. And so I talk to my children a lot about this being passed down to them. And my oldest child is a boy. And so he's like, Ma, it's Jesus Girl, but I still need an accountant. I still need you to be CCO. I still need you to be COO. I still need you to be in the business. So it may be more of feminine products, but as he grows that entrepreneurial spirit, he may be able to think of something that he can branch Tia Mora's Closet off to be, you know, something. And maybe suave men apparel. Who knows? Right. But it's good that you're just, you know, putting it out there and starting it for him. And so I am so glad that you share that. And this brings us actually to our second question. What do you hope to accomplish through your business?
To be honest, it's not about the financial gain for me, because I'm used to the struggle. You know, I was a teen mother. I had my oldest son at the age of 15, and it's hard, right? It was hard for me. So right now for me, I want to see my clients, my women, smile. I want them to have an experience with me. That's what I hope to accomplish. And I'll dig a little bit deeper into that. But right now, it's about the experience with me and my potential customer base.
Thank you. In our pre-interview, you did mention something about, you know, that image that everybody is trying to achieve. That it's not realistic. Everybody is an individual, especially women. We come in different body types, we have different tones, we have different textures, we come from different backgrounds. And so something that you're pretty very passionate about is just making sure that everybody feels confident and comfortable in their own skin. Do you want to kind of elaborate on that and what kind of, like, why you're so passionate about that and why is it so important for every woman in your eyes to view them own selves and their own beauty, just accepting and embracing their own beauty instead of trying to be like the next person?
I just think that social media, the age that we in with social media and just the media, even television, has created a warped sense of beauty standard, especially amongst Black women and women of color, Latino women. I just feel like we're not all the same, right? Our bodies is not a childbearing woman's body. It's not perfect. It does have stretch marks. It does have a bit of cellulite. It does have some fat, and that's okay. Nobody's perfect, and I just want us women to embrace our bodies. Our boobs, they sag. They're not perfect, right? I want us to embrace that and know that you are beautiful, and it's not about the clothes don't make you, right? You make the clothes. Your body is your body, and you need to accept it, embrace it, and wear it proudly. Because I know I do. I got two boys, so I definitely have a mom bod.
And I thank you for sharing it, because one thing that I've noticed as well is that when you own who it is that you are, you naturally attract people that will embrace who it is that you are. You are the first person. I read it like this in a quote, that you teach people how to love you. And so when you embrace who it is that God has called you to be, or the person that God has created you as, then you don't have to worry about fitting into that own standard. And I also believe this plays a part as well in dating. When you're fully confident in who you are, you don't have to worry about your mate comparing you to the next person, because they're attracted to who you are. They're attracted to you, and it won't be in comparison to the next person. So I'm glad that you shared that. And this is actually going to lead us into our next question. So what were some of your triumphant moments in business that made you realize, like, yes, this is what I'm supposed to be doing? What led you into the fashion industry?
Well, you know, once again, I'll bring it back to my cousin. Growing up with her, she's always had been really, really thin, right? And I always everybody used to tell her, like, hey, you should be a model. Even people used to tell me, and I always used to put myself down, like, no, I don't have that. I'm not a size zero. You know, I'm not a size one or two. And, you know, I'm not the average model type. And even my cousin, she used to feel like that too. Like, she'll be like, oh, I'm too skinny. But fast forward in the life that we're in now, she has done a lot of amazing things, and I'm so proud of the accomplishments that she has made in her life in the model industry, and not allowing her soul to be sold to some of the evils of the entertainment world. But she's remaining true to herself, flaws and all, being a mother and all. And once I started really watching her journey, and she dug deep into fashion, I knew that it was time for me to kind of get back to what I love, which was, you know, beauty and fashion and just women empowerment. It's just something that I knew, this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. So you and your cousin are both in the beauty industry. You're just in different parts of it. You have different aspects of it.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing that. I think that's very encouraging, especially for someone who may be listening on tonight, this morning, whatever time it is, wherever they are. And so this actually brings us to our next question, which is, you mentioned shutting down your business and having to start it back up. How was that experience, and what did you learn from it?
I actually started a online cosmetic line back in 2019. It was a lipstick line. It was all vegan, all natural. And I put that to the side because well, one, we got hit with a pandemic, so nobody was really wearing makeup or going anywhere at that time when 2020 came around. And so I just got really discouraged, and I put it on the back burner and I let it go. And I kind of just focused on my career in the nursing field and literally just forgot all about it. And what made me start back up and revamp and completely change everything was a really bad experience that I had at the job I was working at the time. I was being harassed by another person, and it forced me to make a hard decision and leave patient care. And even though it felt like a punch to the stomach at the time, it was the best decision that I could have made, because it allowed me to have time to create Tia Morris Closet and get back into what I know best, which is being an entrepreneur, speaking to women, and just kind of like being an inspiration to others that might be afraid to take that leap of faith. So that experience of working and bringing me to the place that I'm at now is why I'm here.
Thank you for sharing that. I think that sometimes some of the hardest or the most worst experiences that we have in life birth some of the most beautiful blessings. Just imagine like going through labor, you know, when the entire 9-month process, your body is changing, and then you go into the delivery room, you go through all of this pain, and then you behold this beautiful baby boy or baby girl. And so it ends up all being worth it. And so I'm just so grateful that you shared that. It may have been a hard experience, but it pushed you into your destiny. And so I just want to ask at this time, our next question is, what were some of the greatest hurdles with the restarting process? You didn't go back to lipstick per se, but mm-hmm. you went back and you started this new business. So what were some of the greatest struggles with starting the business or going back into entrepreneurship after working for?
The uncertainty of knowing whether it's going to be successful or not. I think that was one of my hurdles, but my greatest one was the financial capital, being able to fund this business. You know, you get a lot of people who tell you, oh yeah, I started a business with $100 or I started a business with no money. And yeah, that might be their experience, but in the real world, it doesn't work like that. You have to spend money to make money. Period. I don't care who tells you what, you have to spend money to make money, at least in a legitimate way, right? So I had to pay for the restart of my business license. I had to pay for a lot of different things that I didn't do in the beginning for my old business that I learned that I had to do for this business. And those resources were very limited because I'm literally using my own savings account to fund this business that I really believe in. And that right now is my biggest hurdle, the financial part of it.
I would agree with being an entrepreneur. The financial part is difficult. I would say the blessing for me starting this business is that my family is very supportive, and then I do have close friends that are like family that are supportive as well. But that is a huge hurdle with starting up a new business. So thank you for sharing that. Mm-hmm. So this is actually going to bring us to our next question. In spite of those hurdles and in spite of those struggles, you're still doing it. So what is your daily motivation routine? What do you do to stay motivated and keep at it on a day-to-day basis?
Well, there is a couple of people that actually keep me motivated, and these young ladies were strangers to me in the beginning. They actually were following my other business when I had it, and then when I shut that down, they never left my side. One in particular lady, her name is Melissa. She is one of my most loyal supporters out there. And I remember having a conversation with her, and I apologized to her for, you know, not giving my business enough attention. And she told me, she said, "Naisha, it doesn't matter if you shut down for a year. If you thought that I was going to leave your side and stop supporting you, you must be crazy." And I'm sorry, I'm getting a little emotional. When she when she told me that, it put the battery in my back to realize that a lot of your support may not come from people that you actually know, family, friends. And I don't have really much of a big family or a lot of friends, but knowing that I have some type of support, even if it's from one person, is what keeps me motivated to continue in my business.
I think too, I'm glad you said that, because as you were saying that, one thing that dawned on me that I don't think really many people realize is that you're your first supporter. And when you believe in something, even if other people don't believe in it, you keep believing in it and keep building it, and eventually they'll start believing in it too. It's just like when you plant a seed, or even when you plant a seed and you say, "Oh, this is going to be a great tree one day." People may look at you like, "It don't look like a great tree. It just look like a seed with some dirt covering it." Mm-hmm. But you continue to water it. You can continue to speak life to it. And then as it grows, that's when the supporters come. And that's because they can see it. Many people don't have that kind of faith where they can see the vision before it comes to pass. Even with my own family, I think that I kind of put everybody, as it pertains to my business, in a position where they either supported it or they just didn't speak on it, because I guard it like my child. And when I say that, I actually had to say this to one of my other friends who I interviewed on the podcast and for the Boss Up season. I have my banner up. I have written scriptures over it, words of affirmation. I've had my children, some of my siblings, they have put declarations on it as well. And if people's words concerning the business don't align with what it is that I've already spoken over it, or what God has given me for it, I just reject it. I just don't receive it. I just act like they didn't say, you know how people ignore people? I just act like they didn't say anything. Mm-hmm. Because I'm just so passionate about it coming to pass. And in my eyes, just like you see a football player, a quarterback, I think that's the position. Running down with the ball, in my eyes, it's a touchdown or it's a touchdown.
Yeah, I agree.
It's a touchdown or it's a touchdown. Like, we can't afford to drop it, because when I drop this, I'm dropping my legacy. When I drop this, I'm dropping my ministry. When I drop this, I'm dropping my livelihood. So even though it may be hard or challenging, I'm going to find the way to make sure that it succeeds, because when it succeeds, I succeed, and everything that's attached to it succeeds. And because I have a Christian-based business, not only am I succeeding, God wins. I mean, he wins. And it's a slap in the enemy's face that you're not going to be the only one out here with people doing, you know, scandalous things behind the scenes. God can raise up righteous business owners and entrepreneurs that will live for him and according to his word, that will employ people and do right by them. And so thank you so much for sharing it. And I just hope that that was encouraging. And I hope that's encouraging to any other entrepreneur that's listening in, is that your business, your vision is your baby, and you have to guard it and speak life over it if you want to see it really flourish. And as you believe in it, other people are just going to believe in it, because it's either a touchdown or it's a touchdown. And that's just it. It's either a touchdown or it's a touchdown. And so this brings us to our next question. Okay, so how has your faith in God kept you going through these trying times? You mentioned the pandemic and everything that you had to experience before you left the health field. So how has your faith in God kept you through those times and brought you to the place that you are now?
Well, once I left my previous employer, it was hard. I didn't know what I was going to do. But to be honest, when it all happened, I felt a sense of peace. I felt like God put me in a position, in a difficult position like that, to bring me out on the other side. I think under normal circumstances, most people would cave, and they would be like, "Oh my God, I got to scramble. I got to look for another job." But in my case, I didn't do that. I haven't applied for another job at all. And everything went down in September of this year. And I have not been employed by anyone else except myself. And I think because I prayed to God and I asked him and I said, listen, I know I'm not perfect. In no way, God, am I perfect. But I have seen you work too many miracles in my life, from me being a 15-year-old mother not knowing what to do with a baby to bringing me through a tumultuous relationship to bringing me to where I am now. So if you can get me through all of that, I know that on a financial basis, you will make sure that I have everything that I need. I don't care about the wants at this point, at this time. All I'm concerned with is my need. I'm able to provide a roof over myself and my child's head, food, the necessities, and I'm grateful for that. So I knew that me praying and keeping my faith strong is what keeps me here now. I don't feel that right now in my life. It's a trying time. I don't know why. I can't explain it, but I just have a sense of peace because I know that God has me. It's like I feel like he's just holding my hand through this whole process, and I'm so peaceful.
And you know what? I'm so glad you shared that, because just the fact that you mentioned that he sustained you all of this time without you working, you still have, you know, shelter, you still have, he's made provision for you and for your sons. That's just can attest to his glory, that even though you're not currently working, you're working and you're running your business, that God has been good and God has been keeping you and God has been providing for you. And so that is awesome. Mm-hmm. Awesome. And so this brings us to our next question. If you could give advice to a young entrepreneur and mother, what would you say?
Oh my God. Listen, I'm going to be so clear on this, right? Your dream, your talent, and your passion is something that nobody should have the ability to snuff out. And if everyone possesses a talent. Everyone, I don't care what it is, everyone on this planet possesses a talent. And you talking to a mother who was a 15-year-old mom at the time, didn't know nothing about nothing, barely finished high school, did finish college, but later in my years, and keep going. It doesn't matter if no one believes in you. Like you said, as long as you believe in it and as long as you are passionate about it, it will work out. Nothing happens overnight. The best entrepreneurs, the best successful businessmen and women, it took them trial and error, years, sometimes, you know, months, years, whatever, to become successful, but they never gave up despite the trials, despite the hurdles, they just kept going. And for those coming up, because honestly, I'm still a fresh entrepreneur. You know, I haven't been in this game very long. And I have my moments where I want to kind of cave, but I don't. And I want to tell you all, keep going no matter what it is. I don't care if somebody tells you, oh, well, I don't think you should be starting a business in the pandemic because, you know, that might be risky. Listen, that's their problem. And don't ever let someone project their fears onto you. So keep going.
Awesome. Awesome. I'm glad you shared that, because I think we talked about this in a pre-interview, just some success stories that took some time. But you look at Jeff Bezos,
right,
and Amazon. It took him years. They actually showed a picture where he was in an office and Amazon was like written on a cardboard box that was like torn. But look at how far it's come and look at how great it has become. And I think he's the richest man. If he's not the rich, I think he's the second wealthiest man. And I don't know if it's the world or in America. Someone correct me if I'm wrong. But he had to believe in his vision, and he had to believe so much to, I'm sure he had people that doubted. I'm sure he had people that spoke against him, just like Albert Einstein, just like the person that invented the light bulb. All of these new inventions, they were not well received in the beginning. But once you see that it's work, it works. It's like, oh, just like
yes.
with the airplane. You know, yeah. you know, who thought about an airplane? We were all driving. And, you know, I wasn't alive, but people who were, they were driving or walking or however else they were getting around. And something in their mind said, hey, we need to fly. We need to be able to fly like the birds do. And they created the airplane. And so every invention is doubted in the beginning. But once people see that it works, then it's, hey, okay, I'm in agreement. How can I sign up? And so we can't even be mad at people who doubt us in the beginning, because, I mean, it's just human nature to doubt something that you've never seen before. But it's up to us, if we're going to be the one that's going to carry it through, to have all the faith in our business. Oh, how's your business going? Great. Amazing. Awesome. Top of the sales. You know, speaking right. well, speaking those things that be not as if they were, speaking it into existence, because there's power in your words. And so I'm so grateful that you shared that. Keep going. Keep going. And so this is actually our second to last question, and then we'll open it up for the people that are on to ask any questions or give any feedback that they would like to. Are you proud of how far you have come? What is your long, and are you proud of how far you've come, and what is your long-term goal?
I'm definitely proud of where I am today, and that I've had the courage to stand on what I feel and what I believe in, which is my brand. And my long-term goal, honestly, is to open up a fashion house where more so like a brick and mortar, where my women can come in and have an experience. I want them to be able to have a space where they can have meaningful conversations, they can have light refreshments, and they can get their entire life in my fashion emporium. I do not own a boutique. I don't like using that word because I just think it's so cliche, and that's not the direction that I'm going in. Tia Mora's Closet is not a boutique. Tia Mora's Closet is a fashion emporium. We will have, when I tell you, we are so different than your average Instagram boutique or online boutique that you see. I'm just totally, totally different. So yeah, eventually here, I live in Virginia by way of New York City, but eventually I would like to open up an actual storefront. I want to get back to the basics. I want people to have a place to come in and experience a fashion house, not just click a button and shop online. So for those that are in the DMV, it's coming. A fashion house is coming.
Thank you so much for sharing that. And so we're just going to ask, how can we contact you? How can we shop Tia Mora's Closet? How can we, what information can we give to the listeners that they will be able to connect with you, or if they have any questions concerning your business or your brand, or maybe they may be able to help if they want to support you in any way? How can we contact you?
Oh, yes. Well, right now you can follow me on Instagram, which is Tia Mora's _ Closet. So that's Tamoras_ Closet. That's on Instagram. I'm also on Facebook at Tia Mora's Closet. And then I do have my personal Instagram, Naisha Tyiease, where you can follow me. I do post a lot of inspirational things there. A lot of my family stuff is on my personal page. And Tia Mora's Closet actually will be launching officially on November 15th online. So you can have a final sneak peek into our, well, actually you can get a preview. If you go to www.tiamorascloset.com, you can input your email information, and from there you will be subscribed to our, I call it a tea list. And from there you'll be able to get notified when new items come in. My fashion house is exclusive, so the pieces that you see on the Instagram page will not be fully stocked. Some of those pieces, it's almost like a one and done. I believe in not having my women walk around looking the same. I want everybody to feel exclusive, and this is the reason why certain items in the shop are literally only a one and done. You won't find it again. It might come back, it might not, I don't know, but that's how you can connect with us now. I would suggest going to my website, plugging in your email information, and signing up for our tea list.
Awesome. I believe I did so already, but if I didn't, I'm going to go ahead and do that. And so thank you so much for interviewing with us on the JesusGirl.ent podcast, Naisha. We wish you the best of success. We pray God's blessings over your business and prosperity to you and to your sons, your legacy that are going to take this to the next level. And we just pray that you continue to keep going. Even if you may feel a little discouraged, we just pray that you just keep on going, because you're going to save some lives. You're going to transform some lives, even through fashion. One thing about women is we like to look good. And so a good outfit will change your mood. It will change your entire outlook. And so that is very important. And so I'm so grateful for you. And I'm going to give the ladies that are on an opportunity to unmute. And if you ladies want to pray for her, or you want to give some words of encouragement or ask some questions, you can absolutely.
I just want to pray for you and just bless you as you go forth your journey. There's just going to be some ups and downs, but mostly ups, but sometimes the downs can be very tough, coming from a mother and father who own their own business. I know what it's like. So, Father, we just come right now lifting up Naisha to you, Father, as she begins her journey with her vision of her her closet, for those to come in and find healing, find restoration. And you, Father, as she begins her journey, the vision that you've laid out for her, Father, that nothing won't turn her around, Father. And when it gets weak, does she turn to you and look to the heavens and ask, Lord, come and help me. Give me strength. Give me courage. Give me wisdom to be able to finish this race, Father. And so we just thank you for her, for opening up her heart to love not only thine self and you, but to love others. That's the second and equal important commandment, is to love thy neighbor, Father. And so as she go forth, that she would touch and change lives through what she's doing, through you, with you, Father. We know that it's not her own, but her own strength, but it's within you, that she has her strength and her being and her living and her life, and that you are the one who's the life giver, and she's just a spokesperson for you, as the young people say, your mouthpiece. So we thank you, we honor you, and we glorify you, and we lift your name up in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Miss Stacy, do you want to share anything or ask any questions?
I do want to encourage you as well, Naisha. I think it's amazing. I too am in Virginia. I'm in Loudoun County. So I'm looking forward to the fashion house, and whatever you need. If you want to do any pop-ups or anything, I can help you coordinate it, because these ladies out here will buy up. I know they will. I've only been out here a little while, and honey, that's what they live for. But you were talking about the Capitol. You were absolutely right, because I heard the testimonies of people who say, you know, oh yeah, I started my business with $10 and a prayer. Well, amen for you, right. And that miracle of yours, because baby, I was working extra jobs and,
right,
you know, trying to sell t-shirts and plates to build some kind of capital. And I'm sure you probably, as you've established your business model, one of the things that really helped me was establishing a Duns & Bradstreet number. Duns & Bradstreet gave me visibility into business credit. it helped me to create a profile where I was made visible to, and it was outside of my personal credit profile, where I was able to get lines of credit that helped me to be able to kind of launch different entities with low interest rates. And so if you don't have a Duns & Bradstreet number, it's absolutely free to create a Duns & Bradstreet account and profile and get your Duns number. They do charge for like different resources. I haven't used any of their paid services, but if I can help you in any way with any of those insights into any of that, just let me know. I don't know. I don't profess to know a lot about business capital. I don't. I'm still learning a whole lot. I learned all of this helping my husband and my son get their business model established and get their business off the ground. And to the point where my husband was actually able to quit his. He was working. He was an executive for Target for 20 years. He had gotten up to the executive level. He was a level one when he started and worked his way up to a management level. He was able to quit after 20 years to partner with our son. And now they currently together, they partner to run a successful mobile detailing business. And so had I not learned a lot about that capital, building the capital and the investment funds and how to get all of that stuff established, we still would have been trying to figure stuff out. And so, yeah, if I can help with anything, please let me know. But I'm looking forward.
Thank you so much, Miss Stacy. And I actually do have a Dun & Bradstreet number. So that is, I'm glad you brought that up because a lot of people don't know about Dun & Bradstreet. But yes, I already have my Duns number. So a lot of things that are coming to me now are in my business name. And as far as capital, I'm also on Hello Alice, which is how I found Miss Boss Lady that's holding this podcast. Because we're on Hello Alice. So I have applied for quite a few grants. I'm also going to be partnering with the Arlington Chamber of Commerce because I live in Arlington. It's a lot of great resources there with them that you can network. So yes, I would be appreciative of anything and any guidance that any of you ladies and you, Miss Stacy, can help me with because I'm still new to this. But I think it takes a village to raise an entrepreneur.
I'm glad that you said that, Naisha, and I'm so grateful. That's why I love community. That's why I love community. And one powerful tool that my mentor taught me is that you don't destroy relationships, you define them. And so even if, you know, certain people don't kind of give you that niche, you may not be able to go to tea or go out to lunch, but you may be able to establish a business relationship. And I am in agreement with Miss Stacy. I also have a Duns & Bradstreet number. It's just it's a complete new world when you go from working for someone and then running your own business. So it's a lot that you have to learn, a lot of information to take in. And so I'm so grateful that she has offered that information to you. On this app, you can actually use the back channel to get each other's emails, information, if you want to exchange. And I believe she will be a wealth of knowledge for you, Naisha. She's a powerful woman of God, very loving, very caring, no hidden agenda. So I think that would be a great connection for you all to make so that she can help you in that regard. Miss Plachette, I'm going to actually give you the opportunity to share as well. Naisha is a new entrepreneur. She owns and she founded Tia Moore's Closet. But I want to give Miss Stacy and Naisha a few more minutes to, or seconds, however long it's going to take them to finish their exchange. And then you can go ahead and jump in. I just wanted to share that community is very important. And that's why I'm grateful for the people that God is sending in my life. And as you said even before, Naisha, it may not be people that you know, but you can come to know them. There's a lot of people from my past that are not present in this season. There's no ill will or anything. I mean, they're just not present in this season. God is just sending new people. And some people that have been around are present. But I'm just embracing the season and embracing the community because we need each other. And just like they say, it takes a village to raise a child. I'm glad that you said that it takes a village to raise an entrepreneur. And that's a good saying because, you know, they used to have those town shops, you know, mom and pop stores. And everybody visit them. You need the support of your village and your town to help it to be successful. So that was great. And so I'm just going to yield the mic to Miss Stacy if you want to share some more, or Miss Naisha or Miss Nicole or Minister Nicole or Miss Plachette. You all can do so at this.
Oh, no, I didn't have anything else. I just, you know, I want to encourage your journey. I'm looking forward to it. It just sounds, and I love that you showed that difference between, you know, a lot of the boutiques and things like that, that you're making this more, because I think that's something that our community as women of color, we need more of that, you know, kind of that expression and expansion of fashion and even other ways, creative ways of things that we already do, like hair, nails, and clothes and stuff like that. So I love that you are trying to stand up, that you are standing up, not trying to, you are standing up a fashion house that not only focuses on the aesthetic, but it really kind of helps kind of instill that intrinsic value that's often missed when you talk about that fashion sense that you have. And so I'm excited. I'm going to follow you on Instagram and check out your pages and stuff like that and see how I can support. Like I said, I don't know a lot. I'm still learning. I'm still literally tripping and falling and learning, you know, trying to solidify this business model for my husband and my son. And they've been in business now for 2 years. And now I'm trying to look at what the implications would be or how much of a challenge it would be, because we're looking to relocate. We want to leave Virginia. And so I want to see how much of an impact that would have on the business to kind of switch it to other states. And so as much information as I find out, I'll be happy to share it with you. And I'll share my information with you in the back panel.
Okay, Miss Stacy, yes, please share your information with me. I would love to stay connected with you. And I do have some other things that I can offer you as well, as far as how to move your business statewide. I got some really good information on that. But to go back, so my mantra for my fashion house is believe in thyself, for you are beautiful and loved. That is my mission statement. That is my mantra to all women. Believe in thyself, for you are beautiful and loved. And on you notice, like I said, I don't like using the word boutique. Every time you go on Instagram, you see the same exact thing. A lot of these young women are getting their clothes from the same person. They're all using the same model, that same cookie. No. My fashion boutique, my fashion house, see, I just used the word, I can slap myself. My fashion emporium and my fashion house is totally, totally different. It's going to be an experience. So Miss Stacy, yes, please keep in touch with me. And Miss Nicole and Miss Pochette, I'm open to keeping in touch with all of you beautiful ladies.
Well, I just want to say that Stacy just confirmed what God put in my spirit to tell you, and he told me to begin to network, and not just network with anyone, but network with like-minded people like yourself, right? That have your morals, to have your values, to have your integrity. He said begin to connect and the doors will open.
Wow, that's powerful, Miss Nicole. That your words of wisdom just actually sent some chills down my spine. So I'm really, really appreciative of your words of encouragement and wisdom.
Yes, this is a new season for me to be able to pour into others. And God gives it to me just like that. And before they even begin to speak, he had already given it to me. Before they even began to say anything. So I know that when you begin to network, the doors of opportunity are going to open up like never before. Like never before. Your testimony is going to be wow. I'm just letting you know. That's what he put right in my spirit before they even began to talk about it. He said, tell her she needs to begin to network with like-minded people.
Thank you so much. And I feel it. I feel like this is a safe space. I'm in a sense of peace right now. And I go off of vibrations, and I feel like the vibrations here are so organically peaceful. I don't feel any kind of stress. At first I was a little nervous, but that nervousness actually went away fairly quickly. So I'm really appreciative to be here.
Praise God.
Person, minds are clear. We just want to send blessings to you and say thank you so much for coming on and interviewing. Thank you, ladies, for sharing your words of wisdom, your prayers, your support, even offering help. That's what's needed. And we'll just close with a statement that Naisha said, it takes a village to grow an entrepreneur. And so we're so grateful for you, and we're so grateful for everyone else that came on. And so I'll give you opportunity to give any final words, and then we'll close the—
Oh, me? You want to give me final words or the audience?
You!
Oh, me! Oh, me! I'm sorry. I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you all. All of you ladies are so beautiful, not just in your profile pictures, but in spirit. I could feel it in this room. You all have a sense of purity, and I appreciate that. And I appreciate whatever support that I can get. And I think information for me is the biggest form of support outside of financial. I think being able to share information with one another can definitely catapult your life to the next level. It can literally be the changing factor. And I think that's the problem. We don't share a lot of information with each other. And I'm a connoisseur of information. So however I can help, I'm definitely willing to do that, and I'm definitely open to receiving information. So thank you, ladies. It is much appreciated.
Thank you all. And oh, Miss
Pl— Hi. I'm sorry. Hello? Oh, okay. Because my screen stayed poor connection, so I'm sorry. I came in like on the butt end of everything, so I just wanted to know, like, Naisha, what city are you in? And I just want to be of help, so I know if I could connect any dots, I would love to just know what city you're located in, and the information as far as your business. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I'm actually located in Arlington, Virginia. I am from New York City, born and raised, but I've been here now about 3.5 years in Arlington, Virginia. So I'm close to Washington, D.C., and I'm close to Maryland. Hopefully my business, brick and mortar, my store, will be either in Maryland or Virginia or D.C. I'm not sure. I haven't gotten to that point yet, but everything is online at this time. But that's where I reside. I reside in Arlington, Virginia.
Okay, perfect. Because I do have a program that I'm starting up, and it's with my nonprofit. It's called Beautiful Ashes Project, and I go to different drug rehab programs and help with their job readiness. And I know I'm good at doing hair and makeup and all that type of stuff, but when it comes to styling, I'm a little older, so even my own style, sometimes my daughters will say, nah, don't wear that. So it's just good to have somebody younger to kind of, just if I would, you know, reach out to you and say, you know, I got a couple of shirts and pants, how can I put those things together? You know, just really getting the women their confidence back, that when they do go in for a job interview, or they go even, you know, out into the world after they've been, you know, held back with drug addiction and different things, is that it's like all of that type of lifestyle have torn them down. My goal is to replace, my motto is to replace the ashes of your past with the beauty of your future. So I try to do that from working from the outside in, because I know if they're in a program, the program is working from the inside out. But sometimes even in society, when you see a young lady not up to par or looking, you know, a little, you know, not as everyone else, people tend to criticize or look down, or, you know, shame the person for not keeping up with the times or the hairstyles or whatever. But when you're coming back into society, you need somebody to kind of direct you in the path that you should go. I'm not saying, you know, dress provocative, but I still want the ladies to be classy, but as well as, you know, embracing their own beauty. And like I say, I know how to dress me to a certain extent. I'm good with hair and makeup, but when it comes to putting outfits together for other women, those areas, I sometimes Google things or look on Instagram and say, oh, okay, she matched that with that. So I definitely would like to, you know, just get in contact with you. So I could suggest it to the ladies. Like if you need a few pieces, you know, you guys can shop on this particular website and get some outfits and stuff like that. Because like you say, it is cookie cut out here. Everybody's selling the same stuff. The more you reveal, the faster it sells. But I don't want the ladies to come from, you know, prostitution, walking the street, different stuff is that, to come into society and now you basically dress the same way you were when you were out, you know, using drugs or whatever, you know, your thing was. I really want to make sure the ladies are polished and classy looking, in their own beauty. I don't want them casket sharp, but I do want them to represent themselves well. So thank you, Shaniqua, for including me in this group, because I go on the 29th to speak to these ladies about self-care and different things like that. And the clothes part, I haven't even grasped that part. I'm just basically like, what you need done to your hair? You know, how's your skin? I haven't even wrapped my mind around the fact that I'm gonna have to make sure that the ladies, you know that what's good to wear to an interview and what's not good to wear to an interview, you know, or what's good to wear just leisurely, you know, when you leave in the place. You know, I don't want them to feel like they're out of place. They already have so many different obstacles as far as getting their kids back and different things as such, you know, court things and stuff that they have. So, I mean, just to find a website they can go on and find a nice outfit already put together, you know, that'd be just really a blessing and a help to the program as well.
Thank you, Ms. Plachette, for sharing that information with me. We can definitely connect on the back end. And let's exchange some information. I'm definitely all about, I love the fact, first of all, let's talk about the Beautiful Ashes Project. That is beautiful in itself, just the name. I really, really like that. And my items, I'm not a stylist, so I just want to put that out there. I do know how to put clothes together, but I am not in no way claim to be a stylist. I have my own sense of fashion. I've always been very different, so I don't follow. I've never been the type to follow the trends. I don't do lace fronts and all that. And there's nothing wrong with that. I just personally have my own style. I don't subscribe to what you see on Instagram. And neither does my fashion house. And if those ladies are definitely wanting to shop with me, they can definitely do so. Like I said, my pieces are exclusive, so they will not be walking around with the same pieces. And also, I have a Curvy Girls collection that's coming out. I think we're going to be putting stuff out, I think around either mid this month or in the beginning of December. A lot of those items are timeless pieces. They are not revealing. They are geared to women who, everyday women, but I don't want to just gear it to, like you say, casket sharp. Boss Lady and Minister Nicole is on here, and you know, you have women who are women of faith, but that still want to look beautiful and feel beautiful. And that's a lot of my Curvy Girl pieces. Conservative and modest, I should say, with some style. Modest with style.
Okay, the Lord just dropped in my spirit that you too, that this is going to come to pass. Woo, the story.
Wow, that was awesome. I really love the fact that at the end, the community came in, those other women of God came in to support Naisha, to give words of encouragement, empowerment, to pray, to water the gift that God put on the inside of her so that it can begin to even can flourish even the more. And so I'm going to link all of the information in the description for you all to be able to contact her if you want to make a connection, a partnership, or just want to know more about Tia Moore's Closet. All of the information to follow her on social media. Also, please do go to the website www.tiamoorescloset.com and put your email address in so that you can get email notifications when the actual website is live, so that you can be one of the first ones to find out about all of the new fashion that she's releasing. And then also, in addition to the great things that she is doing, two of those women that came in to support her are also doing some amazing things. And so Plachette is hosting a gathering on November 29th in the Atlanta, Georgia area. And she is actually going to be having an event for people that have struggled with substance abuse and are survivors or probably still in the midst of the process. And the name of the project is Beautiful Ashes. I'm going to link the information to support that cause in the description. In addition to that, Miss Stacy is also releasing she's already released the book, but she's having a virtual book release on Sunday. So I'm going to leave the information in the description if you want to stream that and be a part of that process. I am so excited to see what God is doing in the lives of his people. And so just a little major announcement that Jesus Girl ENT Podcast is sponsoring all small businesses by doing promos, free promos from now until December 31st. And so if you have an event, if you have a business, if you have a gathering that you're hosting and you want us to give you a shout out on the podcast, please do send me an email and we'll be sure to get all of that information out to the masses so that people can support your calls and know more about what it is that you're doing. And so until next time, thank you so much for tuning in. We want to send a special thank you to Naisha, her family that have supported her, her cousin who gave her the inspiration, and everyone else that supports her and her movement. We love you from Jesus Girl ENT Podcast, and we're so proud of you and all that you're doing and all that you're going to continue to do. And so until next time, know that we love you all, and Jesus loves you even more, and that you are beautiful in his sight. Walk in who it is that he created you to be and own it. Talk to you soon.
To it, how would you ever know what you're worth? You're swimming in your tears, you're crying over lies, but have you seen the good in goodbye? Why don't you go run away from here? Why don't you go run? Take a chance, you never know. But you don't know it's beautiful. Anything is possible. But you don't know it's beautiful. You know, you know, you know, you don't know. You know, but you don't know it's beautiful. You don't know, you don't, you don't, you don't know. You know. Back to when you were a child, innocence was all you could find. Before they took your years, you grew before your time. You don't see the good in goodbye. Run away from here. Why don't you go run? Take a chance, you never know. But you don't know it's beautiful. Anything is possible. You don't know it's beautiful. You know, you know, you don't know. You you need to know. Let it go, go risk it all. Believe, and then you see.